You know, I value my culture more since I'm living in America, because I thought there were free women here. And I realized actually we are much more freer than them.
Whether you're a professional dancer or just started falling in love with ballet dance, welcome to the Ballet Dance Life podcast. Here, we are diving deep into all facets of ballet dance world that cannot be found in a workshop or an audience seat. Every week, you will find new, honest, thought-provoking, inspiring, and educational conversation with top leading professionals of our industry. I'm your host, Iana Komarnytska, and I am honored that you are part of our dance tribe. Jelena's BDE is excited to offer many training and performance opportunities to intermediate and professional level dancers. Visit joinbde.com for information on how to join their professional cast or to train and perform with BDE Experience program. Gain a unique and professional level experience with training in technique, choreography, performance, and theatrical productions alongside Jelena and her team of directors. Information is available at joinbde.com. Happy New Year to everyone! Welcome to 2020 and to our first episode of our third season. This is our third year together that we are going on, and I really appreciate you tuning in, and I know you have so many things on your list to do, but you still find time to tune in and listen to us. And I know many of you actually are trying to do double tasking and multitasking while doing something else, like groceries or cleaning or maybe stitching your costumes, and tune in the podcast and still find and carve the time to listen and be with us. I really, really appreciate it. And also, I kind of feel that the beginning of the year, it's very inspiring time that we have so many different hopes and dreams and goals, and it feels like a fresh start. Even for those people who don't believe in New Year resolutions, it's still just the energies in the air, and it does feel like this. And often it makes us look back also and reflect on what was happening. And this is something that was recently also on my mind. I have been ballet dancing more than 15 years. I think already 16 or 17. I lost the count at some point. And during those years, of course, my journey of learning and studying was all over the places. There was many teachers, multiple workshops, festivals, and a lot of time dedicated to my own practice, especially the moment that I moved to Canada. My ballet dance practice was mostly done on my own. And with that said, it creates quite a few, let's say, challenges. And I'm not even talking about the challenge of identifying your own mistakes. I'm sure you know about my absolute love to video recording your own sessions and what a great tool it is to see your weak points and dance and things that you need to focus on. But the struggle that I'm talking more about is the struggle of having self-discipline. Not only about getting up and doing things, because this we also can manage with some tools of like putting in advance in our calendar, starting early in the day, or creating a reward for like doing this session, and then at the end we can get some nice reward for ourselves. But I'm talking about that self-discipline of always giving 100% of your energy to the session. Whenever you don't have anyone observing you, whenever you don't have anyone like pushing, do it now, do it better, whatever, like we always, or often at least, we can get into the mood of feeling like not enthusiastic or like a little bit lazy. I was like, or dragging ourselves through this session, or even if not dragging, but just really not pushing ourselves to our true limits, which actually is the way and the only way to improve. And for me, I realized that one of the main triggers for not doing it properly and as a result not having the results that I would love to see in my dancing was not being able to start my sessions in the right mood. And this was quite a challenge. Like they have a saying, start your day, win your morning and you will win your day. I kind of feel we can transform, win your warm up or beginning of the session and win your the whole entire dance practice time and improve your dance levels. But starting the sessions was really sometimes frustrating, especially if you're not in the proper mood and you're not focused and your mind may be somewhere else. So yes, you carve that time in your schedule, but you didn't carve that time in your mind sometimes. And then what kind of warm up to do, how to get into this groove, also how to make sure you're incorporating technique drills into the practice, which are often very boring just to repeat and drill, but that's how we create body memory in our body muscles. And that's how we learn dance and improve it. But if you're not doing it with 100% focus, attention, and energy, we often will practice them wrongly. So we will create a wrong body memory, etc. So I really at some point was very frustrated on how to deal with all that stuff, which led me to two things. And I remember it resulted in first endless online classes that I was enrolling whenever I could, whenever I got interested in something, and also occasional private classes, also online, but private classes with teachers that I liked and wanted to study with, and that I could afford at least from time to time. And each of those classes, either online or private online class, they were usually eye-opening. I was always focusing more on technique rather than choreographies. And they were eye-opening in the sense that how many actually exercises just are in this world, existing in this world, that someone came up, and those exercises can help to improve technique, either directly doing this movement with certain attention, or like a related exercise which will relax or engage or stretch the muscle that is blocking the proper technique on another movement, and all this stuff. So it was always very inspiring and eye-opening. But then again, facing the question of like self-discipline to actually do them on a consistent basis, because doing it once, twice, or even three times, it will not get the result. And then we need to keep going even when we don't see visual changes. We still need to go keep going to reach the goal. So with all that frustration and sort of a closed loop of okay, inspired, okay, again, problem of inner motivation and self-discipline, I once got a crazy idea that I do not want to invent the wheel of bicycle again and again. I want to solve this problem for myself once and forever. And instead of every time coming to my session and thinking, okay, how to start now? What should I do now? Should I do this? Should I do that? What kind of music to put? What to do in general? How, like, before I go to choreography, how to do proper warm-up and work on technique and in which order? Basically, I decided to solve it once and forever, and instead of thinking about this every time and thinking about this trying to find something new every time, I decided that I will come up for myself with a regular routine of just, this is the routine, this is what I'm doing, this is how I start my training session. It's like my morning routine, which we all have, is like get up, go brush your teeth, make bed, get breakfast, get out of house to wherever we need to go. That's basically, even if you don't think about that, but that's our regular routine, which you don't even think about or analyze, we just do it. So I decided that I will do the same for my dance practice. At least I will not fight with myself on how to start the practice. I will just have something to do. And I even went further, so instead of memorizing the sequence, whatever I came up, I actually video recorded myself doing it once. And then the next time I just had to turn on video and follow myself, which was a bit funny to follow myself, but it solved the problem. Like I basically stopped once, thought about all those exercises and drills that I wanted to, and I knew they will be useful for me. I put them all together once in this complete routine, and I video recorded it, and then I start using it again and again. So It really took the headache of trying to push myself to get into the groove by just simply following the video and doing it, and that's it. And of course, with time, I got more and more ideas for different exercises that I want to do for myself and different technique drills and aspects. And of course, instead of one, this silly video recording, I got several ones. And you also probably know already a little bit about me and my nature. At some point, I decided, okay, I also maybe want to share it with other people. Why not? Like, if it helped me, it probably will help other people. And that's what I actually start doing via our Patreon page, which is now transformed into a Iana Dance Club, and I know it will help many other dancers too, and that's why I got really passionate about this project. And also, thank you so much for everyone who joined already Iana Dance Club. It was a surprisingly big interest among you, and I really appreciate and hope you're also enjoying and improving your training sessions. But I really wanted to also share this story with you, not only about Iana Dance Club itself, but also to encourage you that sometimes our big projects or things that can help and serve other people, they typically come from a very, let's say, egoistic places. They come from trying to solve our own needs and make it easier and better for ourselves. But sometimes we don't think about those things as something important, and we always try to serve and think right away for other people, or we care about other people more instead of focusing on our own needs. And we don't think about our own needs as something that eventually can actually help other people. So this was an example that I wanted to share with you about Iana Dance Club. And the podcast, I already said several times about that in our history of podcasting, it also came from kind of a selfish place. Like, I wanted to have this space and opportunity to talk to other dancers and hear about their experience, and podcast was a great tool for that. And of course, I'm also very happy to share everything with you too, and I know it helps and inspires you too. So in the beginning of this year, I really wanted to bring your attention that don't only focus on big grand goals or whatever we want to achieve, and don't focus on the end results, but also focus on the process and on your own needs. Because by taking care about yourself, you're not only freeing your mind and health and in general, like, your life to have space to help others as a more fulfilled person you yourself, but also taking care of your own needs may force you to find some solutions that can help for other people. So never underestimate the importance of taking care of yourself and also solving your problems and finding the systems to get you on the track, not only focusing on that end result. I want to be a super cool dancer, successful, international. Like, think about, okay, but what's behavior I need to have? What's now can I do? What is my system or ritual or routine or whatever you call it can be with that? And on the topic of self-care, I'm so thrilled, absolutely thrilled to start this year 2020 with such an inspiring interview and such an empowering guest. And this interview, this conversation had so many surprises for me, and I'm absolutely sure you will absolutely love it, because we have a gorgeous Amel Tafsout on our podcast, and her story and her spectrum of dance activities is just beyond imagination. Raised in Algeria, Amel grew up with traditional healing practices of her native country, and we will not only talk about traditions of North Africa, not only Algeria, but in general, where is the dance culture of Maghreb, where is the Arab dance culture, where they cross, where they go together, where they different. We'll of course talk about traditions and a little bit of history and theory and cultural overview for you, but also we will talk about the healing aspect of these dances and culture in general and how different it is from Western culture. And Amel has a really interesting insight and opportunity to see this both cultures from inside, because even being raised in Algeria, she actually spent a lot of her life outside of her own country. And in 1970s, she moved to Germany, where she founded the Pan-Arab dance company called Banat As Sahra, Daughters of Sahara Desert. And then in late 80s, she moved to UK, where she also created a new dance company called the Tafsoutettes. I hope I pronounced it correctly. Also, she was performing at various dance and music festivals and being an active member of the Latin jazz band Chakchouka, the North African music ensemble Mambo Duniya, and the Arab-Turkish band Noor Shimaal, as well as the North African music ensemble Saladin's Orchestra with her drummer husband Salah-Dawson Miller. Currently, she lives in the USA and she's an in-demand dance artist and musician, and she also has a list of groups that she is and project that she is working on. But I kind of feel that her very important project is with a research in dance and anthropology, and coming from a Sufi spiritual tradition, she really combines traditional healing with sacred dance and with her learning experience in sound healing and zirk, as well as breath work, whirling, and trance. And all this we discussed in this interview, and there are so many points that were eye-opening and very intriguing. It has definitely added something on my list to do and goals for 2020. And I am absolutely sure it will be great inspiration and great way to open this year for you too. So here we are. Please enjoy a beautiful interview with Amel Tafsout. Hello, dear Amel, and thank you so much for joining us today in the podcast. I know so many dancers, once they saw the announcement of this episode, is just jumping out of excitement to hear from you and to dive more into the dances of North Africa and all other really cool and interesting stuff. So thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. Thank you. I appreciate that very much.
I really would love to start to dive back, get a time machine and go back to your childhood. And you were born in Algeria, and probably dance and music were part of your day-to-day life. But can you tell us a little bit more about those times and how those elements were present in your daily life?
Thank you so much for the question. So I was born in the mountains and is northeast of Algeria, and this area is called the Aurès Mountains. The Aurès Mountains are known for various things. One of them is actually, as you know, Algeria was colonized by the French from 1830 to 1962, and the War of Independence for the independence broke up in the Aurès Mountains, and the war was not usually it's by students, but it was by peasants who started. I mean, they wanted to be free, and that was the beginning of the struggle. Mm-hmm. So that area is also an Amazigh Berber area. So the people from that area, they are called the Shawia people, and so the There's a lot of history there because that area, the east of Algeria and Tunisia, the long time ago, it was called Numidia. And Numidia was actually part of the Roman Empire, and then they wanted to be independent. A very famous queen at that time is Dido, for example. So, but when the Arabs came to North Africa, they came actually from Egypt. And that area where I was born is known for a Berber queen. I am using the term Berber, but I don't feel very comfortable with it, especially nowadays that we have an identity. We try to really do a lot about our identity as Amazigh people. So I prefer to use the expression Amazigh because the word Amazigh means the free people. The term Berber was, it's the Romans and also the Greeks. That's how they called us because for them, we were barbers. The Greeks and also the Romans thought they had the civilization. And everything that is not Greek or Roman was barbers. So in Greek, they used actually sometimes even in the old Greek songs, North Africa is called Barbaria. So, so we were the barbers for them. But nowadays that we have this amazing, we were fighting a lot for our identity. So I prefer to express use the term Amazigh. So this queen was from the area where I was born. Her name was called the Kahina. Actually, the Arab historians called her Kahina. And Kahina nowadays, even if you go to Egypt nowadays, and if the word, the term Kahina is very negative in Egypt. They called her the Kahina, which means a little bit the sorceress. But she was a warrior. She was also, I call her a diviner or divineress. So she was a little bit kind of shaman. And when the Arabs came, pushed them away to Libya. And she also arrested, she had a lot of prisoners. And then she freed the prisoners. And she was very well known for... nobody knows about her husband. She was the queen, and she had two sons, and one was Christian, and the other one was Jewish. And she came from a Jewish tribe, and there was a lot of discrepancy about her. Was she Jewish? But was she Christian? But that wasn't important, for example, to me. Because where I was born, the town is called Khanshala, and there is nothing in the history about her daughter, but everybody where my grandmother always said Khanshala was her daughter. So I grew up with all this awareness and the history about this amazing queen that we had, and she was very fierce. So basically, that is the area I come from. There's a lot of history over there. So when I was little, you know, there was this, it's like being born in two cultures. And I was born in my home with my family. I was really like... in my Algerian or Sharia kind of upbringing, with storytelling, with singing, with drumming, with dancing. And in that area, there is not, for example, the Amazigh women, they didn't veil. The veil is really in the city. If you go to the city, women, they veil, but because those women, they work in the field, they didn't veil. But the so basically, I had to go to school, and at that time, it was a French school. And going to the French school, you weren't allowed to learn Arabic. So we were still part of the Arab world, even if you had we had another dialect. So basically, you had to go to school, and at school you had to learn by heart that Christianity is your religion, and the Gauls were your ancestors. And actually, even as a little child, I knew something was wrong because I wasn't the same as the French girls who were in the same classroom as me. So basically, it's always like, okay, the French were better than us. And even at school, the French girls would be in the front row and we were in the back row. But we had to learn the French, and everything was about French history, French geography, but nothing about our own country. So my father, bless his soul, as much as my grandmother, because I come from a very ancient family, and we had a kind of a Sufi lineage. So we my father would gather us around the fireplace, and he would tell us stories about Islam, or but that is the upbringing I grew up with. But you know, when I was four, we had to go to the Quran school. So when you are four, you go to the Quran school, and then when you are six, you go to the French school. Mm. So as a child, it was like everything that was home, I didn't want to share it with the French people. A very interesting example is the teacher would stop me after the class and would ask me the name of my father, and I wouldn't give it to her. And again, the next day she would do the same. And it was like, that is my world, my private world with my family. I am not going to give her the name of my father. Mm-hmm. Until one day I asked my, I spoke to my mother and I said, you know, the teacher is all the time bothering me about the name of my father. And she said, why didn't you give it to her? And it was like suddenly I had the permission from my mother. Then everything was okay. But it was like I felt like I had to protect my own culture. And that's what I did as a child. So everything was different. Hmm. The you know, the things that I share, and that more you are more aware of those values is when you leave home. When I moved to Germany, and suddenly I started all that upbringing came back to me, and it was like I was so fortunate. And I feel unfortunate that I had my culture. I hold to my culture so strongly, because that was the only way I could survive by myself in Germany or in other countries. So the singing, it's all, it has all to do with everything, you know. Like in the West, you are a dancer, or you are a drummer, or you are a musician, or you are a storyteller, or you are a cook, or you are a weaver. But everything was together. My mother was a weaver. The storytelling happened when women would be cooking, or if they are making couscous in the summer, for example, all the women gather together. And then they are singing, they are telling stories, they are laughing, but they, it's such a beautiful way to absorb everything as a child without, you know, we didn't have schools to go to, mm-hmm. to learn our dances or our music. So is everything as a child, you absorb everything. you absorb the songs, you absorb the rhythms, you absorb everything. And also a very beautiful memory when I was a little, because, you know, we didn't have a lot of toys. You had to make your own doll, for example. Mm-hmm. And the region where I come from, we had a lot of clay. So we kids, we used to go outside and play and make different shapes. And then the challenge was, I don't know if you understand what a couscous pot is. Mm-hmm. A couscous pot has a pot and it has a sieve on the top. And when you succeed making your own, then you make your couscous. Mm-hmm. And so then you cook your first couscous and you invite your girlfriends. And then I remember we used to two spoons in a glass bottle, and then we take a cardboard box, and then we start drumming, and the two spoons is to making more like a cymbal, like cymbal sound. We clap and sing, and then we start dancing, and that was the parties we used to have as little girls. So we are not because others, they are busy. They are busy. They have more kids. So we just entertain ourselves with dance and singing and drumming, and that is the best way to learn.
Wow, that's such an incredible story, and there are so many things that I really want to touch on deeper. And thank you for sharing it. It really, like, I felt like transformed into those times and that places, and imagining little girls cooking couscous and dancing. And thank you so much for sharing this beautiful story. But one thing that especially caught my attention, because I never really realized how much connotations are connected to the term Berber, and it makes total logic, like what you're saying, and it can be even obvious, but I just realized that, like, for instance, for me, coming from ballet dance world, and I know most of our listeners, they are ballet dancers. In ballet dance world, we almost feel like some kind of admiration about the term Berber dances, because it's so exciting and so interesting to learn, but it's also very little information about this. So whenever we see someone doing Berber dances, it kind of... literally almost like a feeling of admiration. Oh my God, do you want to learn more? But never connected any bad connotations to this term. And it's great to know that there is an alternative to Amazir that the community prefers to use. And I think at this moment, a lot of our listeners, dancers, have a little eye-opening revelation right now. Like, oh, are we not even realizing about that? But I also wanted to ask you also about... I mean, right now I'll use the term Berber dances with all respect. I'm just, because
that's
for ballet dancers, it's more familiar what we are talking about. But I know that there are a lot of confusions for ballet dancers among terms such as dances of Maghreb region, Algerian dances, and Berber dances. Can you help a little bit to clarify what is what and where they cross each other and where they're different? Because it's really something that I kind of feel may even create a lot of misinterpretations by dancers who are trying to put performances on stage, and sometimes really confusing what is what, or not even understanding themselves what exactly they are doing or performing.
Okay, thank you. It's I have to go back a little bit to the beginning of my career as a professional dancer, and everything happened to me when I was in Germany. So I wanted to show something else than just a cabaret style, and it was interesting that I met some Arabic women at that time who felt the same as me, and I created my first company, and I had Lucy was Lebanese, Samira was Tunisian, there was another Algerian, and there was a German who was Sufi, and actually a kind of she was Hungarian, German, but we were all looking for our identity, because I mean, when I left home and I went to Germany, I didn't really know what I was, because I didn't know very much about my own history apart from what my father taught me. And the first thing when I was with, for example, Arab students, and they were all male, and they said, "Oh, but what are you Algerians? You are not Arabs. You are not French." And even a professor, studied Middle Eastern studies, and he used to tell me that all the time. "What are you Algerian? You are sitting between two chairs." And it was like this longing for finding out who I was. And at that time, it was about me as a woman, wanting to belong to something, to know who I really was as an Algerian, what is becoming an Algerian. And so at that time, because when you become independent, the government said we are part of the Arab world, and Arabic is our language. And a lot of people who actually, especially in the mountains, because that's in the mountains where we had so many invaders in Algeria, that people were hiding in the mountains, and they kept their culture, they kept the Amazigh Berber culture, as well as the dances, as well as the language, and they didn't speak Arabic. So here I am in Germany, and when I had my troupe, in the beginning I didn't want to call it belly dance, because I have to tell you the truth, I am not very keen of the expression, because it doesn't really represent us Arabic women. Mm-hmm. And I had this kind of rejection about the world, and my first troupe, I decided to call it Bedouin, because I didn't want to use the term folklore, because I don't agree with the term folklore, and especially living in like in France and also in Germany, it has such a negative connotation, and the negative connotation is also among belly dancers. So if it's folklore, it's very simple. They think everything that is has to do with folklore is very simple. Yeah. It's just, you know, you do some line dancing or you do some circle dancing and you have one or two steps and that's it. And that attitude is only when they got deeper in wanting to study that, there is not as simple as that. So this is talking about the term folklore, because I would like to come back to that, because I prefer the term than folklore. The confusion about the Berber in this kind of let's call it belly dance is because they. You know, in everything, if you want to cook, you really have to study how to cook, or you have to be with your mother and let her teach you. You can't just pick up some, I'm going to pick up some cumin and mix it with curry and say, oh, I am doing an Indian dance or an Arabic dance. It doesn't go that way. So there is a big confusion, because there is something that is happening that didn't happen at that time when I started being a professional dancer. I started in the late 70s. So I was the only one trying to bring something else in the dance scene than the cabaret style. And I remember in Germany, everybody was interested in the cabaret style. because the cabaret style didn't come really from our countries, it came from America. And so what I was doing, they thought is simple, or they didn't really pay attention not to the movements, or they couldn't really pay attention to the movements because they couldn't see them. It's not about just doing 1,000 movements with your hips. It's the whole thing is together. Mm-hmm. If you are doing your hips, you are actually doing your shoulders too, or you are using your hands. Because first of all, because you know, in North Africa, we don't have just Amazigh Berber dancers. We have the city dancers. I call them the city dancers. Mm-hmm. And those city dancers, they have to do with they are Andalusian dancers. They have to do with the Moors when they came from. When people talk about the Moors, they think they are all Arabs who came from Damascus. Actually, a lot of those Moors, they were North African Berber Amazigh warriors, and they went there. So when they came back, the Andalusian style started being and is still going and performed, and that is the city dances. So if you go to the mountains, and sometimes also in some oases, you do have the Amazigh Berber dances. But there is one common thing about those dances that I love so much, is they are fertility dances. So when we talk about fertility, people don't understand, and they simplify the fertility. The fertility is the fertility of Mother Earth, but is also the fertility of the woman. Can you believe it? Where I come from, when they used to do the sowing in the summer, when they start sowing, basically putting the seeds, they always used to have a pregnant woman present. And when the harvest comes, the first people who get the first fruit of the harvest are young girls. So it's a whole cycle. And the cycle is not just about that kind of fertility, is also about, you know, the stamping that we do. Of course, you have the Debke stamping in the Levant. We have, it's very gentle. It's like I care for Mother Earth. I am communicating with her. It is as if I'm breathing with her. And that is a very beautiful kind of connection. But also, it has to do with you as a human being, especially with the hands. When we do the hands, it's not just doing any kind of... So the arabesque movements, they are from the city. But in the Amazigh Berber, when you are using your hands, everything I am doing has a meaning. Mm. It doesn't have just a meaning that I know about. It's about the energy. So because as a human being, I am creating the connection between the Mother Earth and the universe. So it's the whole constellation. It's about not just about Mother Earth as a planet, but it's also about all the other planets and the stars.
It's really interesting to see this connection to Mother Earth and ground in so many different traditions all around the world, but especially in North Africa, Middle East, and Central Asia. It just, whenever you were describing it, it kind of reminded me, I believe, the Iraqi Kaulia dance and their steps. Yes. And they're beating the earth. I know that it's more about awakening the earth, but of course it also has a lot with this meaning of Mother Earth and connection to Earth. And it's so interesting to hear the same analogy in other part of the culture, and having the same similar meaning in the dance embedded.
Because I believe that we all come from somewhere. Mm. And I believe if you look at Native American dances, And I go to powwows where I live. There is one not far from me. And how they are dancing actually is exactly the same dance as the one I do. If it's the Kabyle, for example, it's exactly the same beat sometimes even. So there is something unspoken because we are different, but we are similar too. There is a similarity. I was doing a dance. It was for actors in London, and there was an Indian choreographer, and I was doing one of the steps that we do in the Tunisian, and the guy came to me and he said, "Ah, oh, we have exactly the same step." So it's very interesting because, you know, we talk about fusion and we talk about fusion as if the term fusion is new. People traveled a long time ago. Mm. They traveled with ships, but they traveled also with camels, and they stopped somewhere, and you know, and they got something from that area where they stayed. A very good example is people from Africa going to Mecca. Then they had to travel by camel, and they had to come to North Africa, or then there is a whole journey that they had to go through. Sometimes it took them 1 or 2 years, but they still got something from the places where they stopped, if you see what I mean. So I would like to come back to the to your question about Berber and Algerian and this and that, because North Africa was only one country a long time ago. It's why I am a typical North African who has a family. I am from a big tribe. Some of my tribe is in Tunisia, and another tribe is in Morocco. And that is, and then the French created those borders. And when they created those borders, it doesn't mean that, okay, a Moroccan is a Moroccan 100%. An Algerian is an Algerian 100%. A Tunisian is an... No, it's not like that. They have, actually, we have connections. We have family. We have relatives in the different countries, because people are people. Politics is politics, but people are people. And so... especially Algeria is in the center, and I don't know if you know, since Sudan became divided in two, the biggest African country is Algeria, mm-hmm. and the biggest Arabic country is Algeria. Mm-hmm. So if people, when I came back to America, what do they know about our dances? They know one Algerian dance, they know maybe one or two Moroccan dances, the Shikhat and the Gedra. What do they know about the Tunisian dance? Only one. And they have no idea that we have a lot of dances, a lot of music, and there is so much that I am still discovering. I go to Morocco on a regular basis. I went to Egypt. I travel a lot, and I travel also to study, not just to go there. But I am actually organizing this trip, and I'm very grateful that now it's full. It's taking dancers to Algeria, and we are going to different places, and it's a cultural trip. I am doing it for those dancers, but in a funny way, I'm doing it also for myself, because I feel, you know, it's like an artichoke. More you take layers, and more you find there are more. So it's like I'm still trying to find out more, because there are the desert dances that are so amazing. And one of them is the dance of the lead nail, that is actually not a Berber dance, mm-hmm. but people think that is a Berber dance. You know, there are all the spiritual dances that we have. So there are so many different ones, And unfortunately, the people who went to Algeria, a lot of them, they went to Algeria in the 70s. And sometimes I'm very fortunate, I'm very happy that they brought something to the West, but their knowledge is very limited. And unfortunately, sometimes they added to more prejudices. Mm. I am against prejudices. It's like there are more stigmas. The stigma, a typical stigma, and I have done a lot. My grandfather used to be like a judge in that oasis where the dancers of the Oledne came from. And the dancers, they when they do that dance, they think they have to have a cigarette in their mouth.
Yeah.
I mean, there is no, even when they do, what is called again, there is a dance that is now everybody's doing. They don't have a cigarette on stage, but when they are doing the Ulad Nail dance, they think they have to have a cigarette on stage. And when I say no, they don't understand and they get really mad at me and they bombard me with colonial postcards. And I say, you have no clue how those postcards have been taken. The photographer is putting that cliche there. But the thing is, that area didn't have women. They didn't smoke cigarettes. The soldiers brought cigarettes and alcohol. Mm-hmm. So there is always a history behind it, if you see what I mean. So one thing about now American tribal belly dance, like it's called. You know, when I came the first time here, and one of the people who invited me to teach was Carolina from Fachans. Mm-hmm. And at that time, she was very interested in the roots. And she was very interested about the North African roots. And if you, as you know, the headdresses they have, that is an Algerian headdress. They got inspired by that, which is fine. But, you know, when everybody is putting their tribal, their tattoos on the faces, and I am in those festivals, I'm sorry, I cannot even, I don't feel I want to put my tribal marks on my face. Because it become like everybody's doing it, but nobody understands that those tribal marks, they have a meaning and you have to be initiated. You can't just put them on your face. You know, if I want one, I can't go to the shaman and say, hey, I want a flower in my cheek or in my hand. She is the one who is going to decide what I need. Because some of those tribal marks, they are carrying energy. They are carrying a healing energy too. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's like everything is mixed up now. Yeah. And I am not surprised that they're pretty confused. Because they are confused, but are they going to listen to me or to one of us who come from the country and going to doing it, not going to stop doing it. So the way to talk to them, I am not going to be angry and spend my energy. I am going to do it another way. I want to teach them. I want to educate them. I want to open my arms and tell them, here I am. I can tell you. I can show you how things are done if they want to. Are they going to want to? That is another story. Because we are living in a time where everybody thinks, okay, they can go to YouTube and just see some movements and put their dance together and they think, okay, they are professional dancers.
Well, I still have a lot of hope that there are a lot of conscious dancers there. And I really truly believe that the more information, the more discussions we have, the more it actually broaden up the horizon for many dancers and understanding. Because a lot of them, they
follow whatever they heard first, or they took workshops from some teacher and they trust that information. And many dancers may not even realize that they have some misinformation. So the more we have opportunities to actually discuss and bring up those topics, I really think it will, not immediately, of course, it takes time to change and make dances to have and develop their creativity, but in a conscious way, because it all comes from the desire of, oh, I just want to experiment and be creative, but then sometimes taking the wrong path or wrong way and go into some elements that we don't even fully understand what's that. So that was exactly the reason why I actually asked you about, in general, even the question of what are those like dance styles, because for many dancers, whenever they hear, oh, Algerian or Tunisian dance style, they right away associate, oh, it's probably Berber dance style, Berber Amazigh dance style. So on top of that, there is a term Maghreb dances. Yeah.
Yeah. So about the beginning, because I was by myself, and I had a Tunisian in my troupe, and all those Arabic women, we wanted to give dignity to Arabic women. That is about dignity. It's why I never danced belly free, and I want to show that we have beautiful costumes, and it's nice to, the costumes, they have a reason sometimes, like there is always this stigma about our dancers dancing naked, for example. And if you take the Gedra dancer, if you take the Nailia dancer from the Ulet Nail, without the costume, nothing makes sense. Mm. So, but there is all this stigma about dancing naked that is really like a male orientalist kind of a view, mm-hmm, about us. So I am not saying, I am very, very grateful that the I have friends, but from an old school, and I appreciate all the work they have done, because they didn't have YouTubes and Facebook and all that to find out. They had to go to the country, and they really worked very hard to give some information. But you see, so when I used to use the word Bedouin, is because I wanted to englobe the Arab world and bring that element and show the, you know, it's not a belly dance a troupe, is a Bedouin dance. And then the term Bedouin started being used, and not really, people didn't understand what that meant. And then I decided, okay, I am now going to focus on North Africa and call what I do Maghreb. Why Maghreb? Some people, that they don't like the expression because they think I am not including the Maghreb in Africa. The problem is, especially in the U.S., some people, they call North African dance, but actually what they are doing is Egyptian dance. Mm-hmm. And people are confused also about, where is Egypt? Is Egypt part of the Maghreb, or is Egypt part of the Arab world? So I think to clarify a little bit, I would like to explain that Egypt is in Africa and in the Middle East. But culturally speaking, Egypt is part of the Middle East. So what we call Maghreb, there are five and a half countries. Mm. That is because when the Arabs came to North Africa, we were in the West, and they are in the East. So you have the Sharq, and you have Al-Gharb. Al-Gharb is the West, Al-Sharq is the East. So Al-Mashriq is actually the Middle East. Al-Maghrib is North Africa, but is also the sunset. So Al-Maghrib, it's Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco, Libya, and don't forget Mauritania. Mauritania is part of the Maghreb. And there's a lot of, depends where you find yourself. The West Sahara for Moroccans is part of Morocco. The West Saharians want to be independent. And so basically this is one part that is part of the Arab world, but it is not in the Middle East. So our culture, I think the culture is different. But what is different in the dance, and I tell you why people get confused, we have other rhythms. Our rhythms are not Middle Eastern rhythms. Mm-hmm. Our rhythms are more related to Africa. So when I see a belly dancer doing North African, I feel that there is something wrong because she's not dancing to the rhythm. So the rhythm is very important. The most of our rhythms, they are offbeat. Mm-hmm. Okay, they are upbeat rhythms. So the one is not, if I'm clapping, I'm not clapping and dancing, or I'm not clapping and singing on the one. So to express it a little bit better, if you have a tabla, if you are playing Egyptian, okay, mm-hmm. you start on the dum.
Yeah.
Okay, we start on the tack.
Mm-hmm.
That is the difference.
Mm-hmm. So it's kind of, it really can throw off a lot of dancers who are used to typical rhythms.
Yeah. Exactly. So we dance on the tack, we clap on the tack, and we sing on the tack. So basically, you really have to change the way, especially if you play Egyptian. I tell you something, a lot of Egyptian drummers or Middle Eastern drummers, they all think they can play North African rhythms. Even they are the best drummers. Very rare that you find one that can understand the North African rhythms. Mm. North African drummers, They can play Middle Eastern rhythms. They can play Egyptian fantastically well, but the opposite doesn't work. So, and that is my dilemma, is finding a drummer who can understand my language. It's very hard. So that is the difference, the confusion. And the confusion is, because sometimes, the Western women, but it's changing a little bit more because you have dancers who are interested in the Silk Road or the Iraqi rhythms. The 6-8, mm-hmm. the 6-8, you find it in Persian music.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You find it in Iraqi music. You find it sometimes even in Khaliji music. But the 6-8 is our rhythm. You see what I'm saying?
Hmm.
So everything is a little bit, some dancers, they like dancing to rhyme music. Rhyme music is very 6-8. Even if they are doing hip hop or if they are doing rap with it, they always respect the rhythm.
It's another beautiful example that in different countries, different cultures, there will be some similarities. So it always comes back to, we probably came all from the same place at some point.
Probably. But that was what I, for me, the beauty about the North African mm-hmm. rhythms. It's like as if you are dancing against. There is some, it's unpredictable sometimes. When I see dancers doing Middle Eastern, especially the routine, you expect the tararan, pom pom, or tararan, tam tam. But with the North African rhythms, it's always like you don't know where you are going, and you know, and that is what is probably difficult for belly dancers to understand is sometimes they think it's repetitive and they think that is what is probably for them simple, but that repetition is not always just a repetition. There is something else going on there in the same time, if I make myself clear.
Yes, yes, yes.
So this is a confusion, and the other confusion, you know, it's interesting, although I do the different styles, I am very fascinated by Mauritanian dances, for example. People think I'm Algerian, so I'm doing just Algerian, you know. And I did study different styles, but I decided to focus my life or to give my dance to the North African one, because now you do have the Persian is more or less accepted, actually very accepted. The Turkish is understood and accepted and performed. You do have the Khaliji now, but the North African is still something people think, oh, it's easy. Oh, in the routine, if you see a belly dancer, oh, they think they can do Tunisian and they can do Algerian and they can do Moroccan. So Shikhat, the Tunisian dance with the jazza, with a jar, and then maybe some gedra, and they think that's it. They are set. They have that. Mm-hmm. But sometimes, unfortunately, when I see them performing it, it breaks my heart. Why? Because they focus on the costuming. They focus on the costuming, and then they mix our movements with some belly dance movements because they didn't do the homework properly. Mm-hmm. And then it looks like vishivashi. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes, yes.
It's not necessarily their fault. It's not done with malice or with it's just they are not putting enough work on that. They would put a lot of work in the Egyptian, but if it's a North African, they still don't understand that they have to do the work. They have to listen to the music if they want to understand the rhythm. It doesn't go otherwise. They have to be familiar with the music. And our music is so rich. I mean, Moroccan music is rich. Tunisian music is amazing. I mean, like Mauritanian, Algerian, everywhere you go, it's another style. It's another style of music, unless it's Andalusian music. If it's Andalusian music, it's played in Morocco, it's played in Algeria, it's played in Libya, it's played everywhere. That's why we have Andalusian music festivals. Music-wise, we do have those festivals, but dance-wise, we do have troops, and sometimes there is always a problem with women performing, even if it's in a troop. So it needs to be known more, and I am very happy now in 2019. I mean, when I started, I was alone for a long time doing what I kept doing it because of the love I have for it. And now I see other North African dancers doing it. And it fills my heart, and it makes me see that actually, yes, we can do it. I have a very good friendship, and I love what she does. It's Rai Saleh. Mm-hmm. Because her work is very, very valuable to me, because she's getting more and more in the roots, and we connect a lot together, and she invites me to teach in Paris, and she respects me. She respects the fact that I have done it for a long time by myself. And you see, it's always different if you are living in Paris or if you are living in Germany or London or America, because Paris is where you find, is the mecca of North African culture. And you can find people. But when you are outside of that area, it's harder to find people understanding, or to find people, even North African people, understanding their culture and try to understand and honor it, because it's always, you know, there is always a dilemma with really it has to do with colonialism.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. Raisa's activities are really super significant. She actually was featured on the podcast too, and it was very insightful conversation too, with many aspects and details that bring more also awareness to this dance culture in general. But also thank you so much for sharing also all this knowledge and your passion to dance, and I'm sure it really clarifies already a lot of things for dancers. I'm sure all listeners already have their brains on fire with all this information and new realizations. But also another topic that I feel I just cannot skip, it would be unforgivable mistake, is to touch on the healing aspect of all these dances, because you already mentioned the aspect of fertility, and we talked about meaning of tattoos and costumes, that it has spiritual aspects too, but I also know that even in your classes you sometimes focus them specifically on the healing aspect of North African dances.
The healing aspect, I think the healing aspect is always present in all the dances in the art world. The first important healing to me is when women are dancing together, and when they are sharing the dance together. Because if there is a wedding, do you know there is a kind of hierarchy, who is the first person to dance for the bride? Mm-hmm. Usually is her grandmother. Mm-hmm. And then is the mother. And they offer the dance to the bride. And then the women are dancing together, because, you know, the solo dance really didn't come, even if we are going back to the Al-Andalus, to the Moors in Spain, in south of Spain. And I have done a lot of research about that, because my ancestors came from Granada, and they were from the Moors, and then they came to North Africa. So I have done a lot of research about the fall of Granada, for example. And do you know they had all those, how can I call it, the entertainers, mm-hmm. in the palaces. And the entertainers, they were slaves. And those slaves, they were the most educated ones. They were educated in every art you can imagine, in poetry, in dance, in singing, in playing instruments, in storytelling. And when I was doing my research, and I went to look in the what the Arab historians wrote about them, is interesting that they are called the Qiyan. Those women, they are called the Qiyan. They never talked about the dance. They talked about them as amazing singers and poets and musicians, and actually were dancers. And that would be interesting for me to find out if those qiyans, those female entertainers, were dancing as solo dancers, or they were dancing together, you know, because that would be interesting to see the solo dance. Did that come from the West, or was it still existing in our world? So basically, in North Africa, it's why there is a big resistance against a solo dancer. And you find out, you find now, even in weddings, if you go to weddings, and then they are dancing together and doing all the traditional dances. And then sometimes at the end, there is a belly dancer. Mm-hmm. And she's a solo dancer. And that is what you find in big cities, for example. Because even if you are without talking about the shikhat, they dance together. Mm-hmm. They always dance together. If they do a solo, it's a very short solo, but they don't dance by themselves. And that is, for me, the biggest healing aspect, that women, because they live together, that they share the dance and it heals them. Because what is healing? Healing is joy. Is joy. Joy of the music, joy of the dance. So that is the first aspect of the healing that I think is it's done with no expectations. It's just very spontaneous that everybody does. And then there is the other healing where it's directed and is focused. And that is the healing, like releasing any kind of disease or frustrations or something like that, or the healing that more you find in the desert, because there is the Gedra that is really a dance that came from the West Sahara. Mm-hmm. And then you do have all that area, if it's among the Tuaregs or the Nakh, for example, in Tunisia, they are all spiritual dances, but it's also blessing, giving the energy. When you are dancing, you are actually blessing the people who are coming, and blessing, you bless yourself, but you bless the others. And then you bless yourself, you bless everything. You bless not just the people, you bless the whole universe. And that is the aspect that I like about those dances. Because, so if we are talking about, in Egypt, they call it Zar, we call it Hadra. And Hadra is the presence. You can call it the presence of, but to me, is about the divinity. Because I am very involved in Sufism, and in Sufism, God or Allah or the divine is inside, is in your heart. So it's not outside of you, you know? Mm-hmm. That is not, you are part of it. And that's what I like about the breath work, the Zikr, for example. If you are doing the Zikr, if it's, it has to do with the sound. The sound is so powerful as a healing energy. So the area where I come from in the mountains, and that is going back to the women, there is one singing, a kind of more like a chanting called Aita. And Aita is that it means the scream. And the women do the scream. And I had a nanny, and when she was sad, she would sing and cry. And she used to do this Aita. And I find myself doing it now that I am, it's amazing. And that kind of singing is the sound. And the sound of it is so powerful that actually it's about sound healing. Mm. And the Zikr is about sound healing. So the sound, as much as the rhythm, as much as the dance. They are together and they heal. They can heal. If you are dancing, what is the difference between going to the gym and the dance? It's spirituality. Mm-hmm. You know, the dance, if you are dancing, it's like it goes to your cells, it goes to your marrow, it goes everywhere. If I am gymming, it's like, okay, I have I am just making sure that I'm going to have muscles, or I'm going to feel okay. It makes you feel good too, but the dance has something so deep. And that is the healing side that I like about what I'm doing. So the work that I do that has to do with healing, I think every woman can heal herself. And she does know how to do it. I can give her the tools. I am not healing. I'm not taking her energy. No, how can I express it? I am just a facilitator to help her to release those energies that she's holding for a long time. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes.
It's why I say I'm giving her the tools, I'm giving her the key, and she has to put the key in the lock and open the door. So because I don't have the pretension I am not a guru. I'm not saying, okay, if you come to my classes, you're going to be healed after 5 months. I don't think it goes that way. It's really, you have to listen to the women, because women are so beautiful. And it's so sad. I did a workshop where I was doing some sound, just sound healing. And some women, they couldn't even open their mouth to let a sound come through. The sound that comes through is not the sound that comes from your mind. It's through breath work. And then you let any kind of sound come through. And that sound is so powerful to heal yourself. And when suddenly they started accepting their sound, they had tears in their eyes, because they thought they are not able to do it, especially in the West. You know what we do in North Africa? If somebody dies, the women gather together and they scream, they cry together, and they do like a movement, and they cry together. And can you imagine how powerful that is? And that is like here, like if you cry, you have to hide to cry. You shouldn't, you know, why we have the zagarit, you know? You call it zagarit, or we call it yuyu. That is such a powerful sound. And you know, when the French, the soldiers came to the old cities of Algiers, and they want to go inside the houses, and the women started doing the zagarit, the soldiers didn't know what to do with it, you know, and they were completely confused. If you haven't seen a movie called The Battle of Algiers, would be nice to see it, because you see the power of women. Just with that sound they have, it's unbelievable, you know. So those things, we live with them. We live with them. And, you know, it's like doing a hadra. The kids are there. The elders are there. It's like a daily life. We are not always like you have to have a ceremony. Sometimes in weddings, suddenly the rhythm is so powerful that you see a woman getting in a trance. And then the women take care of her, and she is going to rest a moment, and then she will be okay. I saw that even in a concert, where in a North African concert, where suddenly a woman just gets in the trance, because she can feel, she feels the music. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, this topic of relationship of human with sounds that are inside us. It's quite fascinating. And you were just describing those participants of your workshop that couldn't get sound out of them. And I was like picturing myself exactly in that situation. And I can only imagine what kind of block is that actually to release once you step through that. I never really connected that aspect of the culture to the healing and psychological, emotional healing power or power of it.
I hope you will see it one day.
Now I'm really thinking okay, maybe it's something on my list to try to overcome, because I remember since childhood, I was like, I can't think. I literally cannot get sound out of my throat. It's very weird feeling, and it's probably for someone maybe absolutely not even familiar or sounds strange, but I totally can relate to those participants of your workshops that you were just talking about, because it's actually a physical feeling that you cannot get that sound, either scream or singing or anything, literally physically cannot get it out of you.
But what is beautiful, it's again women together. Mm-hmm. When everybody I like the German expression for it, in English it's called sound healing, but I like the German, it's called a klang teppich, and it's a sound, the rug of a sound, or the carpet, sound carpet. And it's really like that, because when every woman in the group is just letting that sound come through, and in the beginning it's so uneven, and then suddenly it's like an angelic vibration coming through, where suddenly everybody is singing together and creating this beautiful energy. So for one woman to do it by herself is a little bit difficult, but when you are doing it with women together, wow, it's very, very powerful. Mm. I'm very blessed that I can share that with the women, because there is so many layers, and especially nowadays, that there is much more, the Me Too movement and the harassment, the abuse that women always had in their lives, and they never shared it with anybody because they were ashamed about themselves. And actually, they shouldn't be ashamed. And it's always they get punished, not the man. And in our countries, it's still the same. And when you can release all that pain through sound, how beautiful that is. It's why we, I value my culture more since I'm living in America, because I thought there were free women here. And I realized actually we are much more freer than them. We get this amazing connection with our body already when we are little, when we go to the hammams, the Turkish baths, and how we take care of our skin, and how we cry together, and we scream together, we dance together, we sing together. Can you imagine how healing all that is for somebody, And the women sometimes, even if they don't talk, the women know. My mother knows. My aunties, they knew. My grandmother knows. There is all that kind of, I call it a silent dialogue that is going on. But women know. All women know. You can just look at them in the eyes and you see. I can feel sometimes their pain. And it's why I'm the dancer, but my work is much more than that. It's bringing the women together to see that the feminine is so powerful, that we are beautiful, we are powerful, and we need to focus on that beauty we have together. You know, it's the competition. It's America has competition for dance, competition for this, competition for cooking, competition for... It's like, oh my God, people are exhausted. Can you imagine competition for models and there are 11 or 13 or 14? And then when they are 30, they are finished. How sad. And that is my work is bringing the grace to the women, even when they are older. You know, in flamenco, in African dance, even in Indian dance, those are dances that are respected and celebrated. And actually, the elders, more you are older and more you are powerful. And now in our dance, everything is changing. You have to be young and you have to be beautiful and you have to be perfect. And, you know, what about those amazing elderly women who have wisdom, who still have beauty, and they should see the beauty in themselves and not say, okay, I am too old, it's finished, I have to finish. That's what I'm doing. I am keeping going because I want to inspire women, any kind of age, to say, yes, I can make it. I can make it. I can keep dancing. I can keep dancing until I die. Because that dance is healing me.
That's so, so beautiful and empowering and also so refreshing to hear, because that's true. They have so much competition, and not only competition in general in world, we actually have competition kind of among women, as if we by definition need to compete with each other. And then there is all those other layers of social competition that we have in general in the world, that it's really exhausting sometimes. And it even listening to everything that you're saying, it feels so refreshing and empowering. So thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you very much.
Well, I feel we only scratched the surface of all the topics and subjects, and even your activities that you're doing. There's so much more themes and questions and things to discuss, and I feel we can keep talking and talking, but I also didn't even notice how almost like more than an hour already passed by, so it definitely signaled that we'll need to do part two of the interview, because there is still so much left away. But I also know a lot of listeners, a lot of our listeners also have one burning question on their mind. Okay, do you offer any classes or workshops or any activities that they actually can come and study and learn more about all of this that we talked today about cultural, North African culture and dances, about healing powers of the dance and everything else?
I do. I work all over the world, and sometimes I'm so busy that I cannot keep up with my weekly classes. I live in, I'm not very far from Sacramento, and I teach weekly classes. I'm going to start one in January, and but I am doing, I'm going to Oklahoma in February, and I am teaching there. I'm teaching dance, but I'm also teaching some healing. And I am going to I'm taking a group of dancers to Algeria in March, and that group is full. And Then when I come back, I'm going to be on tour in Europe. I'm going to Vienna and Slovenia, and Rai Saleh is inviting me to teach in Paris, mm-hmm. and I'm going to London. So and I have some workshops in New Orleans. I have a website, is www.ameltafsout.com, and I have my calendar there, my schedule is there, and if some people, some dancers would like me to come to their area and teach, I would be very, very happy to share my my energy and my culture with them. And I actually decided, because they don't know so much about culture, that I created a 5-day intensive that I call Maghreb Dance Intensive. And in that intensive, it's 25 hours. They study, first of all, they get a package, so they have to study the history. They get even quizzes for that. Mm-hmm. And then I teach them dance. I teach them the drumming, because I'm a frame drummer. And I teach them how to drum. I love the frame drums, because to me, they are more feminine. The tabla for me is such a phallic symbol, and it's very interesting that men usually they prefer to play tabla. They don't want to play daf or bendir, but there are so many beautiful technique to learn the instrument. And then I teach singing, and then I teach also I teach them costuming. Because that is a very important topic, because sometimes I see the costumes and they are not done properly, or they put the bedla underneath and then they have the North African on the top. And there is one thing that I really would like to share is, please, if you do ethnic dance, if you do traditional dance, don't show your legs, because we don't show our legs. Cover your legs, because that is very insulting for a North African person to see that. If you are doing cabaret, that is your business. If you are doing traditional North African, actually, if you're doing Persian, you cover yourself usually. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there are little things like that the dancers should know. And that's why I do costuming. And I am very interested in the history of the costume, because everything has a meaning. I mean, the stripes, they have a meaning. The woolen belt, the long woolen belt has a meaning. I like to explain also about all those, the symbolism also of the colors, of the shapes, you know, and especially like the jewelry, they all have a kind of, like, just to give you an example, for us Amazigh Berber women, silver is protection. That's why we wear silver. That is a protection that we have. So this is just an example. So the intensive is it's in February. And if you go to my website, you are going to see some information about that. But I am very open. If some of the ladies or the gentlemen, because sometimes I have also men, I'm not against teaching men. I think it's part of the dynamic to have the two energies. So you are welcome to find me on Facebook and. Send me a message, or they can get in touch with you, and that'd be very. You are welcome to join. You can normally I do it in February, because it's easy for the people from the East Coast to get a cheaper flight. And the other thing is, because in California we are starting to have the spring in February. So everything is blossoming when I'm doing my intensive. Mm-hmm. So please let me know if you are interested. And usually what I do at the end of the intensive, I do more or less all the countries, but I like doing also some healing. So usually the Sunday before everybody goes, I do some healing work, sound and whirling, and just to make sure that they get that part of the quality of the intensive also. I think yes. Thank you so much for inviting me to talk, and thank you for what you are doing. I think it's so valuable. I am so touched by somebody like you who wants to learn so much, but you are giving the opportunity to every dancer to listen to you, to your event, and share that with them. I think it's amazing what you are doing. Thank you so much, and hopefully we will meet one day, that our path will cross.
I'm absolutely sure that, and thank you so much for your nice words. It's a big honor me to do all these conversations and share with dancers. And
I appreciate it so much, and actually I appreciate it more that you are doing something for my culture. You are doing something for the tradition also. You are doing something for the roots, but you are also giving us a voice. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart.
It's really my pleasure. Thank you so much. And thank you for finding time and spend us with us and sharing all, so generously sharing all your knowledge and experience with us. I really appreciate. And I also will make sure to add a link to your website and social media to the show notes. So all our listeners, you probably already know that you can always find all this information in the show notes. And already mark February on your calendars, because the event sounds extremely exciting and interesting. And I am very, very jealous, but in a good way, for all dancers who actually already booked their tickets and spots there. And I'm pretty sure the event will be full and great success. And the work that you're doing is really, really amazing. And just before I let you go, we have our signature final question of the podcast that I ask every single guest. Sum up the interview, the episode, I typically ask it about ballet dance, but today I'm going to rephrase it about North African dance in general. And we talked quite a lot about it, but I kind of feel it's always a good way to summarize and sum up and give some final thoughts on it. So the question sounds like, what makes you fall in love with North African dance again and again, so you keep doing it for so many years?
I think, first of all, it's my grandmother. and when I dance, and secondly, what makes me fall in love in the dance is the energy of the music and the energy of the dance. Is like, you know, if I sometimes when I hear a piece, I cannot stay. I have to move. It's like everything in my being, my cells, my heart, my organs, everything is like I can't stay still, and that is it's that energy that you know. You know, like Arabic music has, you know, when I was little, I was also, but because my mother was listening always to the radio, and we were listening to Kulthum and the Egyptians, and that is the music that has the tarab. You know, the tarab it's where you feel happy and sad in the same time. Arabic music makes me feel that way, and North African music, Arabic music is, you know, is the voice. The voice is important. The voice and the rhythm, and what I like about our apart from Andalusian music is very sophisticated, and the rhythms are very complicated, and you know it's classical music. Mm-hmm. But the traditional music, I like the raw. It's raw. So the voices are raw. You know, the singing we have in the mountains, the Berber Amazigh singing, reminds me, is very much like the Bulgarian singing, if you understand what I mean. Is that voice that is the mountain voice, that there is some roughness about it, but it gets deep into your tribes. You know, it's so powerful. And the thing is, when I'm teaching, sometimes I try to be the teacher, and then there are moments where I lose myself in the music. And actually, the students, they like that because they see me like I become like a little girl. So really, that is when I'm dancing, I am like that little girl who is dancing with her grandmother, you know. And that's the feel I have when I'm dancing.
That's it for today, guys. But before you go away, don't forget to screenshot this episode and share it with your friends. And if you post it on social media, please tag me and our guest, because we love seeing who is listening to the podcast. Thanks for being with us, and I'll see you next week. Same time, same place.